And I'll introduce Yolanda Solano in a moment from PRMD. Just have a few announcements to go over. One of my bifocals here. Our last meeting, we had Harrington from PRMD Code Enforcement was here to talk to us about the issue of blight in the Springs and how we can, you know, meet some of those challenges with some of the properties that have been blighted mostly for a long time. And so I think we made some good progress and learned a lot of great things from her and found that she's going to be a great resource. And after discussing this amongst our executive committee, we decided that rather than try to target specific properties or property owners, that we should first step back and kind of come up with a good plan to approach this problem. So what we'd like to do is form a Springs Blight Task Force. Just a few folks who can get together, hopefully someone can spearhead that and come up with a strategy and an approach, because there are multiple options in terms of dealing with blight. The first and obvious one would be just approaching the property owner, but beyond that, there are other means that we have available, so we'd like to explore those before we just sort of plunge ahead. So let us know if you would like to learn more about the Blight Task Force. Our September meeting is going to feature, hopefully the Sheriff's Department will be able to come and help us discuss the formation of neighborhood watches. There was some discussion over the past few months. There's been a number of break-ins, vehicle break-ins, and it just became obvious that that's something that the Springs community could use, not only in terms of safety and security, but just as a good way to bring people together. So September we'll be focusing on that. Also, I think we're going to have, I'm blanking on his name, from Mattson, Ellen?
Oh, Tim Slow.
Tim Slow, thank you. We'll be coming to give us an update on their two projects, the Boys Food Center and the Container Project. We also recently had a meeting. Ellen and I met with Supervisor Gorn and several people from the county and PRMD and Caltrans to go and look at the Donald Gap. The Donald Gap, as you know, is sort of the unfinished portion of the Highway 12 improvement project and something we've been wanting to get some closure on for a while. So we've started the conversation. The big challenge is going to be to find the funding, but at least we're talking and hopefully we'll be able to work together with all the parties and come up with a solution. Another thing we wanted to kind of report on, and I don't know that there's a lot to report on, but there will be a meeting coming up soon to discuss the formation of a MAC, a Municipal Advisory Committee. So that's moving forward, but I think we need to really show Municipal Advisory Committee. So it's basically a citizens advisory group that forms a kind of a liaison between the community and the Board of Supervisors, much the same way that the RAC, Redevelopment Advisory Committee, functioned several years back. So we're looking for the community to support this, and we're hoping that you can contact Supervisor Gorin's office, or we'll be coming up with some opportunities for you to show your support in the near future. So, unless anybody else has any pressing announcements they want to make, I'm going to turn it over to Ellen Conlon, who's going to sort of introduce the spring-specific plan.
Thank you. Thank you for coming. In 2014, Susan Gorin sought on behalf of the Springs, a grant from the Association of Barrier Governments. And as you know, this has been a very, you know, underserved community for a very long time. And I was part of the Redevelopment Advisory Committee, and then when that folded, I joined the Springs Community Alliance. And, you know, we have worked very, very hard. I've been involved for about 12 years now. Well, no, whatever. Probably about 6 years with this organization. But what I was most impressed with was that this organization has been around since 1994, working on these issues of kind of reversing conditions in the spring. So when Susan reached out and secured this grant, I know that I was really thrilled and have participated in the workshops. But it's really been clear to me that a lot of people haven't participated in the workshops and did not know that this is really a major plan that's going to change the vision of the Springs over the next 10, 20, 30 years. I think it's really powerful. I think it's really wonderful. But we want to make sure that everybody participates, has their voices heard, and knows what's coming. I just wanted to give you a sense of what that application that I guess it would have been PRMD made to the Association of Bay Area Governments for the grant. The requirement was that it would align with ABAG's program for complete communities. And what that requires is variety of homes, jobs, shops, services and amenities, and that all of it encourage accessible by walking, biking, transit, that it would reduce commute times, and that it improves the social and economic equality of the area. So that's the original goal. It's a very, very broad plan, which is why we wanted to bring Yolanda here to actually present the elements, give everybody a background. There's a load of information, and she's also going to be giving you some of the process and the points in time where you can participate. So as far as the process here tonight, I think we're going to have plenty of time for questions and answers. I was thinking, oh, maybe we wouldn't, and I have sticky notes and you'd be able, and pencils, and you'd be able to actually kind of fill them in and get your questions asked after the fact. If you don't want to ask a public question, I got the sticky notes. Raise your hand. I'll give it to you. You can fill it in. I can ask the question. We also brought maps, and that's the geographies that, or the geography that we're talking about here. It's not the entire Springs area. It is literally a corridor, which is the Highway 12 corridor. So I think that's pretty much, that's it for me. So Yolanda. You want to just?
Sure. All right. Just to make sure you can hear me. Thank you very much. I appreciate being here and appreciate you all coming. My name is Yolanda Solano. I'm a planner over at PRMD, and I've been working, as Alan said, on the specific plan. We have consultants, a de novo planning group that has been doing a lot of the work on it, and I've been managing the project. So anyway, to begin with, I'm just going to, I was asked to give you an update on the process, on the progress of our specific plan and next steps in the process, and how you can stay involved, and where you can go for information. There is a lot of information. We have a website, and everything, just about everything, is posted on there. So I'll give you that that web address, and also let you know where you can get that. As Alan said, the county has been working on with the community and our planning consultants. It's been about 2 years now. We hope to wrap it up by early next year. The specific plan is intended to create a foundation for a vibrant community with more opportunities for housing and including mixed use, and also improving circulation for pedestrians and cyclists. So let's see here. And the policies, design guidelines, and changes to land use and zoning proposed by the plan are what will be the mechanism for achieving those goals. So let's see, I think I've gone a little too far here. Yep. There we go. The specific plan is meant to reflect the goals and the values of the community, and that's based on input we received during the first three community workshops, and some of them, most of the goals that were agreed on are listed here. A plaza was, you know, a top priority for the community. Affordable and mixed housing, of course. Bicycle and pedestrian transit improvements and safety was a big one along the Highway 12 corridor. Preserving the rural and historic character, diverse multicultural environment, there was a real strong preference for small local businesses. Let's see here. So basically the specific plan, the key features of it include a land use plan, a circulation plan, infrastructure, design guidelines, and a financing and implementation plan. So currently our plan is in a discussion draft form. But I will describe a little bit about each of these sections. So the land use plan would change land use and zoning to create a mixed use corridor that I described, basically from Depot to Thompson. A community plaza is included, increased housing opportunities, and policies to promote the mixed uses, pedestrian orientation, and community gathering spaces besides the plaza, but elsewhere in the community as well. Circulation plan, that includes policies to create a safe, convenient, and well-connected pedestrian and bike circulation system. So we've got more crosswalks in the plan. Currently, the current rendition of that plan, crosswalks, crossing beacons, for safety, and on bike lanes, the plan proposes a buffer. So you'd have, right now we have bike lanes. We take part of that bike lane and create a striped buffer as a separation between the travel lanes and the bicycle lanes. The infrastructure section that discusses sewer, water, drainage, and emergency services, and it includes policies to ensure that those services are going to be available. We have design guidelines, standards to achieve that community vision. And lastly, a financing and financing strategy with potential sources of funding to achieve that, the plan. As Ellen mentioned, the plan doesn't include the entire Springs community, which is over 4 square miles. The plan actually hugs the highway corridor from Agua Caliente Road down to Verano, about a 1.7 mile stretch. And it includes, the Springs itself includes, let's see, I think it's 170 acres, I believe. That's what it was. Well, maybe it was closer to 70. I'll find that.
Yolanda?
Yeah.
Will you also take questions as you go along?
Sure, absolutely. So,
can everybody read? 178 acres,
and in the Springs area, we've got about 726 units.
I'm sorry, just for clarification,
sure.
You're saying the Springs-specific plan is the 178 square acres?
178 acres, right. And it's just this narrow corridor that follows the Highway 12. Highway 12. It also includes, though, the Donald area down here, and as well as the ballpark on this side, Paul's Field. Okay, so this slide shows the major milestones for the specific plan. There's numerous tasks and meetings that occur between these milestones and some crossover, but this is the basic framework. So to begin with, let's see. There were, as I mentioned, I think there were 4 community workshops and 2 surveys that were conducted early in the process, and that was to create the vision for the plan. It also identified preferences, issues, and opportunities. And meetings were also held for the CAT to weigh in as well in that early part of the community advisory team to weigh in as well on what the vision would be for the plan. Our consultants prepared background reports, followed by an alternatives analysis. And next, a discussion draft was prepared for review by... I'm sorry. The discussion draft was prepared for review by several of the committees. The Bicycle and Pedestrian Advisory Committee reviewed it. A Technical Advisory Committee reviewed the plan. Of course, our CAT, the Community Advisory Committee. Sonoma Valley Citizens Advisory Committee will be reviewing the draft next Wednesday, 6:30 at the Sonoma Police Station. So please come if you can. Once we receive all of that input from all of the committees, we will prepare a public draft. And that public draft will be presented to the community at a community meeting. We anticipate this fall, probably October.
Can I ask how you're going to get that information out for us to be able to attend that meeting?
Certainly. So we will have we have an email list, and if you want to leave me an email, I can be happy to add that to the list. We do press releases, send out the press release, and usually the local paper picks it up.
Okay.
Yeah, and also it's on the project website. So, you know, so we will definitely expect a good crowd that night. So the preparation of the draft EIR is already underway. That's running a parallel track to the plan, the specific plan. And once it's ready, there'll be a notice of availability that goes out, and there'll be a 45-day review period for that. The draft, okay, so I've got that. And then we'll begin the adoption process, and I'll go into that a little bit more here as well. Okay. So as I said, the discussion draft is already being reviewed by the CAT and the SVCAC as well. And I've already mentioned that comments are going to be used to create our discussion draft. Let's see here. So the Planning Commission hearings, once we have our discussion, once we have the draft EIR prepared, and we've got our public draft of the specific plan, then it'll go to the Planning Commission. The Planning Commission will review that, and they'll also review both the plan and the draft EIR. Once the Planning Commission has reviewed that, then they'll direct staff to prepare the final EIR. So it's going to go to the Planning Commission at least twice, probably three, maybe even four times. Each time there'll be a public hearing where the public will be invited to share their comments. Written comments can be sent as well. And we always get those to the Planning Commissioners. You can send those either by email or letter. Whichever way looks best, which works best for you. So after the Planning Commission has reviewed the final EIR, then they will make a recommendation to the Board of Supervisors. That recommendation will go to the Board of Supervisors, and the Board will then review the EIR and consider adoption of the specific plan. So that's the basic procedure. So public participation, you know, there are, we've actually reached out in a number of ways to inform the community and try to gather information. We've had 4 community workshops. Again, there will be one more workshop meeting here in the community in the Springs. We've had newsletters. There have been surveys online and surveys left at businesses, small businesses. La Luz had one. La Michoacana had some, and the school also. And we sent home flyers with the students also from the school. Yeah, they were surveys to glean information. There were a couple of them. The first one was for preferences, to find out what we had. One of our community meetings asked for the community to share their preferences, design preferences,
yeah,
and
I
such.
I remember that one. I was just saying for those people that couldn't attend.
Yeah.
There were a lot of people who live in the Springs, and I think the meetings only represent really kind of a small cross section. Springs as a whole.
Yeah, and that was what the attempt was, to try to reach out a little further. We actually received 161 responses to one of the surveys. So it was a pretty good response.
And we had another meeting here at the Springs Community Alliance to kind of replicate your meeting, in which case we also provided that survey. But
that's right.
I'm curious whether that survey, if the survey results are
I don't know if they're available online, but I think I might have, at least from one of the surveys, I might have them with me. If not, I can send them to you. I actually don't know. I don't know if I have it.
One of the surveys was actually people choosing from options. They were choosing from 3 different alternatives. And after you go through this, Rhonda, I'm hoping that you can kind of give people a sense of what people were voting for, you know, what those alternatives were.
Yeah, so the 3 alternatives, one was just no change, really. The first one was just existing conditions. The second one was a moderate growth alternative. And the third was a housing, I think it was called the housing alternative, which provided more housing in the area. And so the more housing was A, the moderate was B, and then the existing was C. And most people chose option, the middle option, the moderate. There was also a number of people, and I think I had the percentages, maybe, I think it might have been 47% for the middle, and then there was also some that were in between. Between A and B, and then I'm thinking it was like 38% to 47%, something along there. I'm not absolutely sure, but it was something like that. So, and it was a little, you know, malleable as well, because there were different things that were preferred in different aspects of it, you know, of the different ones. So yes, so this, so most of the community supported, even in the surveys, supported the middle one. But there was a pretty good showing for choice A, which was the more housing built in.
So how will that be used, or how do you see that being used in design planning?
It was the foundation for the first draft of the design guidelines, and then and I believe it was just under 300 new units. And it, of course, it doesn't. It's all within that narrow section of land that runs along the corridor. It's not in the broader Springs area. So all of it, most of it. I'm sorry. Microphone. So most of the growth, and I've got some existing and proposed maps, most of the growth is going to occur in the Donald area. We've got the Donald area. And another thing that occurred, that happened, is the splash site, the vision changed for that property. And we've got a developer that was proposing 100 units in that area. So that upped our numbers. Counting that area. So, and then one other thing happened that did raise significantly the number of dwelling units that went into the plan, and it was the fires. After the fires, there was a desperate need for housing, and there was a scramble all over trying to find areas for housing. It would have occurred even without the plan, but that did increase the density in particularly the Donald area. When we were looking at more moderate growth in that area, and I can show you.
Talking about the Donald area, could you give us?
Sure, I've got something to show you. So, the Donald area is. It's actually this area here. Here's Donald Street, and this is the area included in the plan. This little extension here, and I'll put my glasses on to see. This is the current way the property is currently zoned. So it's zoned B8, and B8 is a frozen lot size. So what that means is that we were not anticipating a lot of development in this area until it was annexed into the city. So it's basically in a holding pattern. And there are, you well know that most of the Springs is built out. This particular area, there is some land there and some potential for some development. So let me show you. Well, it was on that B8 means that the county was not planning on putting a lot of development in this area until the city annexed it, providing I think it's already having services, but they would be it would be developed in accordance with their plan because it was anticipated at some point to be annexed into the city.
It doesn't appear to me that the city has any plans to annex that.
Well, that was what it was at the holding pattern, that B8. That's what that is. It's a holding pattern. So in other words, you've got a big parcel there. There's no subdivision, even though you've got several acres. There was no subdivision potential at this point. The B8 means that it's being held. And usually the B8 means that it's being held until, a city annexes it. You might be right, there might not be any plans currently to annex it.
If you don't want it, how will that change?
Well, it's in this urban service area, so it still could be provided with services. What I guess the point the point I was trying to make is that we've upzoned it. We've removed what we're proposing right now, it's still B8. But what we're proposing to do is to remove the B8 and then upzone it so that there is the potential. For instance, that dark brown shows the higher density.
What density is that?
It's 20 acre density, so that's 20 units per acre. That's the potential there.
Do you have a preference being rental versus ownership?
The density doesn't speak to that. I mean, if it were to be condos or townhomes, no. And so the orange area is R211, so that's medium density residential, 11 units per acre. So that area was upzoned to try also to provide some opportunities for housing. There are other areas that had an increase in their zoning, the density as well. But as you know, most of it is built out, and that might happen. I mean, it could be decades before it actually occurs. The other thing that you can see is this purple area, and that's a new designation that's being proposed for the Springs, a mixed-use designation. And so that would allow mixed use, right in here, that's the purple, would allow mixed use development without going through a use permit process. It's between Depot at the north and Thompson at the south. Yeah, and and of course, there are about, if it were to develop at full capacity, it would be just over 100 units, I believe, in that area, 120 units. Of course, it's all, it's pretty much currently developed, so over time, this may be a decades-long process to see some change in that area and to see it convert to a more mixed-use community. But the potential, it would be there. So nothing is going to happen overnight. The best opportunity we have for housing is probably in this area here. There is already a development that is in process here, a housing development there, and perhaps at Springs, the splash site, or former splash site. Yeah. So does that make sense? Yeah.
It's Verano Avenue. I can't see.
Yeah. So Verano is right here. It's on the lower part of this plan. I could only fit half of the map on here, so you're not seeing the most. This is Boys. Here is Boys Avenue right here. Yeah. So this is the lower half of the planning area. The church is in that area, and then behind it, there is some vacant land.
Okay, so you'll be building up that part.
There'll be that potential to build that part. Yes, right in, back in the residential area. Hey.
So how are we going to create more parking in this area, because we're already heavily impacted?
Yeah, parking
more
is...
Yeah,
so parking, of course, for housing, you'd have on-site parking for housing development. The challenge was for along the corridor, to provide, along the commercial corridor, to provide more housing. The plan does suggest that, a couple of parking lots be developed, and to do that, there were funding mechanisms, strategies in the implementation plan, such as, an assessment district is one of the things. That is that last section, the implementation section, is still in an admin form. So all the other sections of the plan have been released as discussion drafts, which means that they're still malleable and may change. As a matter of fact, I expect them to change. The community advisory team, the CAT, reviewed the first half of the design guidelines this last Monday and made a lot of significant changes. So hopefully to be more in keeping with, what the community really wants to see. And like I said, the SVCAC will also be reviewing it, and we'll take all of that and produce a public draft. Once we have the public draft and everyone will have an opportunity to see that, it will be available online. It will be available at the community meeting. And then you'll have an opportunity to make comments. We'll take your comments. We'll take the draft to the Planning Commission, so they'll have all of those, and they can consider all of it at that time.
Does the EIR, in terms of the parking issue, because I think what people's concerns are is if we have more units and there's not enough parking for those units, they're going on the streets on either side of Highway 12, which impacts the neighborhoods,
right,
the streets along Highway 12. So I think that's the concern, and I was wondering if the EIR addresses that.
The parking will be addressed in the EIR, and I imagine that we'll get a draft of the EIR probably by early fall. So we'll have the admin draft, and then of course you'll be notified when that's available. The parking is probably the biggest challenge. Yeah.
What about traffic? We had in a couple of discussions earlier, there might be a study made of a signaling system along the Highway 12 corridor. There seems to be a lot of delay at this Boys intersection, which is kind of offsets ice streets that come in there, so the signal takes longer at that one location to change the traffic backs up. So was there any
to synchronize
study to get the signals coordinated?
Coordinate the signals.
Realign streets so you don't have this six way wait for cars from one street to come in. Light changes and cars from Boys Boulevard go, and then and they got the left turn, got a lot of cars that go, I mean, it's...
Right at that intersection, yeah.
Have they looked at that, or will they look at that?
Yeah, the synchronization of the lights, absolutely, yeah.
The alternative of the synchronization of the lights is that it speeds up traffic, and the traffic is already moving faster than posted. And actually, I prefer to have it the light because it slows down the traffic in the corridor. So that is another way of looking at it. I don't believe that there's an offset at Boys like the offset that comes down from East Thompson. That doesn't even have a signal. So at least it's manageable at Boys. So there are lots of different arguments, and some of us have looked at these issues for more than 30 years. So
in my experience of driving,
no, I don't like the drag race.
In my experience of driving the corridor, because I do live off Vallejo, you know, with that, I love that intersection because, you know, you can turn left without thinking you're going to risk your life.
Yeah.
But in my experience, where it really backs up is actually up here at
Siesta.
And then it's not coordinated with where it comes in from West Thompson. And that causes more backup, you know, from Verano, where people cross it at Verano.
I see.
It goes 2-1.
Yeah. You know, I know that the light coordination is going to be looked at, but I'm going to make a note to make sure that our planner is looking at that. We do have a traffic consultant working on that part of the EIR right now as well.
The other thing is that actually it seems to me that it might be a good for East Thompson going in to turn left and get into the flow of traffic rather than the sort of heart stopping, okay, let's go, whiz, and stop. Because since there's no other place to turn left except going quite a bit out of our way, I mean, realistically, down to the Verano Boys, or excuse me,
so there's the left turn there at coming out of East Thompson. Yeah, I'll should get my pen here and write that down. That's a good suggestion.
Did you also write down just to include the CHP on all this as far as the Sonoma CHP and the Napa County CHP, please?
Absolutely. They have been invited to some of these meetings, but I have to reach out to them again.
Yes, please.
Let me write that down. MacArthur.
Is there a way to get through the presentation and go for questions? Because it could be a long night.
Thank you.
So, thank you. So that's a good point, left turn. Okay. So I think I pretty much covered what I was going to cover, or maybe I just skipped that last part here. So the website is the springs.specificplan.org, and that's the website. We have documents. We have all the background reports posted there. We have all the documents that went to the community advisory team. The ones that are going to this Sonoma Valley Citizens Advisory Committee. And so those are, again, discussion drafts that will change, but you could certainly take a look at that to see where we're at right now. Yeah.
There's another report that's actually on there that I do recommend. There's a report on the three alternatives.
There's an alternatives analysis on there. And there's also the background. You were, Ellen, say, well, not that, well, there was, those were all those reports too, but there was a opportunities, issues and opportunities summary, and that actually goes over the community meetings and what came out of those. It doesn't capture that last community meeting that we had, but it has a description of the first through three and all of the, you know, a compilation of all the suggestions that were made during those times.
Yes, there's a lot of information there. And the reason I'm recommending that you all at least take a look at the three alternatives is because they actually kind of show you the trade-offs of each one of the plans. So the highest growth, most amenities plan is one of the alternatives. The one that was chosen for preferred, although they're still flexible, is the one that was called medium growth, fewer amenities. And then the last one was slow growth, no incentives, marginal amenities. And the reason I bring it up is because those documents actually show you what are the amenities they're talking about, crosswalks, where do they go, getting rid of the adding parking on Highway 12 again in certain areas where you won't have a left turn, getting rid of some of the curbs over access to the businesses.
Oh yeah, the driveways, yeah, actually, yeah, the driveways, consolidating driveways.
So you have less congestion with people turning, et cetera. People having to park in the back instead of, you know, parking in front of businesses, et cetera. There's a lot of detail there, but it really gives you the full sense of how the, you know, how this plan will actually play out. And as, you know, she had mentioned, as you wanted to mention, it's still in the works. It's still, you know, have a point of view on it.
Absolutely.
One of the things that I wanted to mention, in that middle plan, because we brought up traffic, that plan actually assessed to increase traffic 14% at the southern end of the corridor and 7% on the northern end. You know, so just, you know, be aware that they even have the kind of the they've done the assessments of what's the impact of each one of these plans. Like the most aggressive plan was a 25% increase of traffic. But anyway, that's not the plan that they're going with. So it addresses recreation, it addresses parking, it addresses transportation, has stats on increased housing, et cetera. So it's a good thing to get familiar with.
And the draft plan has incorporated most of that also. So if you were to look at the plan that's going to the SVCAC, that is the most current that we have right now. So that would be a good one. Yes, that is what you will hear, but you can also view it online if you wanted to. It is online and you can peruse it. But I just caution you that it will change. Like I said, that it is a discussion draft, and until we have the public draft, it can change.
What time and where is it on Wednesday?
It's at 6:30, and it's going to be at the Sonoma Police Department.
There's a good question back there.
In the city. Oh, hi.
So one of the things that caught my attention is the fact that there's a lot of conversation about affordable housing or more development on housing. But as you point out, it's going to take time.
It is.
And while that's happening, there is a concern, and there is a genuine concern that the Springs is becoming more gentrified.
Mm-hmm.
And so, there's a concern that I have around that.
Yeah.
And also the fact that obviously, well, you know, there's this wonderful, you know, that we have this many people here. The you know, I still don't think that we're representing the actual demographics of the Springs.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's a concern. And how, I mean, obviously we want, you know, there is an effort to get the Springs, you know, to become more attractive.
Yes.
But while that's happening, families are leaving.
Right.
Especially after the fires.
Yeah. Yeah, so, right. So how would we alleviate that? Basically, it's trying to provide more areas for affordable housing. As I was showing, bumping up the density, so there is that more potential to create affordable housing in some of these areas, the Donald area and over in the... over at the splash site. And so that's holding on to the affordable units that you have and providing areas for affordable units is how we hope to counter that. I don't think it's necessarily goes hand in hand that, you know, because the community is improved, that we'll necessarily lose our affordable housing so long as, you know, we have the zoning there and the incentive to provide the affordable housing. We do have, the county does have housing programs where we offer increased density in exchange for affordable housing. So those are the types of tools that the county uses to try and counter some of that gentrification, and it is happening all over the county. It's startling. Hi.
So, two questions. So, just compounding on that, and I apologize, I was late. As far as, so affordable housing in the Springs, or in at least this 178 acres, or is it also being looked at affordable housing in other parts of the valley?
Mm-hmm.
And then, secondly, I just want to make sure that I'm understanding the slide, which I'm hoping this presentation will be up on the website, because it's great slides. And it'd be nice to have that, but as far as the next steps, because I'm just one of those people that, unfortunately, for whatever reason, I'm new to this plan.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'm a resident, and I'm trying to catch up.
Mm-hmm.
And so there's this EIR out there that basically is still in the works where I can give my comments. That's why I'm here, right? So I can go up on the website, I can look at it, I can view it, I can
as soon as it's prepared, it's not complete yet.
Okay.
So that's still under work, but you can come to the Sonoma Valley Citizens Advisory Committee next Wednesday if you'd like to. And
mm-hmm.
And there are all those other meetings. There'll be the community meeting, which might be the best opportunity to take a look at it. And that'll be the public draft. So that's, you know, even, you know, more important to go and see that, to see
and
what the outcome
the
of it. That's the one in the fall. And then there'll be at least two, maybe three or four meetings at the Planning Commission and then at the board as well. So there are lots of opportunities. You can send as many letters or emails as you want. All of those get to the decision makers.
Great. And then just to confirm, we're only talking about these three maps, which are the same. Right.
It's just that narrow strip of
right.
land.
We're not talking about anything outside it or around it. We're just talking
nope.
about that, right?
Right.
Just want to make sure I was catching up.
That's exactly right. It. Yeah.
And you know,
sure.
There is a comment period, too.
After the EIR, the draft EIR,
there's
is released?
Well, for the extended comment period, I just wanted to let people know what is that comment period, when does it occur, what's the length of time?
So once the draft EIR is released, published, there'll be a 45-day comment period, but you can, you know, submit comments, you know, at any time on this document, on our plan. Of course, you'd probably be best to comment once you've seen the public draft and submit those comments. All those comments, all of your comments will go to the Planning Commission.
So you don't have to be at the meeting?
You don't have to be. You can send them. No, you can view it online. when the public draft will be online. You can view it online. If there's something that you're concerned about, something that you like, you can shoot me an email, you can send a letter. Those will all go to the Planning Commission when we take the plan forward to them, so they will be aware of that.
I'm concerned about affordable housing, because what's affordable? And is there affordable versus low income?
So affordability, actually, I don't think I have the actual information, but it's affordable to low-income households. And the Community Development Commission has a particular formula for that. I don't actually know it right off the top of my head. But I can get you that information if you want to leave me your contact information and get it for you and send it to you.
Okay.
Yeah.
Because if it's $300,000, that's a heck of a lot of money.
Yeah. It's no kidding. Really. Yeah, I know. Yeah.
Is that being looked at in other areas of Sonoma Valley?
Oh, that was your question, right? I was going to talk. So after the fires, there was a effort to look for housing opportunity sites countywide, and that's been a top priority, since October. So yes, countywide, there's been a desperate search to try and find affordable sites for affordable housing.
And I maybe Susan can answer this as far as our district. Within our district, where besides just in the Springs, where there's 178 acres,
mm-hmm.
We've got a lot of acres here mm-hmm. in the Sonoma Valley, east side, right? Where else is affordable housing going to be put up versus just we are heavily populated with housing already?
Mm-hmm. I can check in with our housing planner, and I can get you that information. If you want to leave me your email, I can put you in touch with her, and we can get you on a mailing list so that you can have that information. Yeah.
So we talked a little bit at the beginning about blighted areas and areas that have been long time blighted areas. I mean, since I was in high school, I've been looking at empty lots, and is there any attempt, it sounds like, to approach the property owners and to figure out a way to work with them
mm-hmm.
and get them to do something? Because I've approached some of our neighbors a number of times.
Mm-hmm.
There's little interest to do anything, so we'll leave it as it is.
Our code enforcement manager has been working with the community here, and I think she was presented last month here. She was showing me, I asked her about what she was doing here, and she showed me a spreadsheet that she has with all of the properties that they're working on to try and get some things cleaned up. I think some of them were vehicles that were out, and or maybe...
To address abandoned cars, that was the first step. She's going to give an update. She wasn't able to give an update for today's meeting, but we are going to have an update for the next meeting. But, her message to us was there's a lot of tools that are available, and that's why Rich was saying this. We really should form a committee to take all of these steps, because there is a process to it. But it was kind of a hopeful thing that, I can't remember what community she came from. She's new to Sonoma County, but she was saying that there are definitely things that can be done, particularly about boarded up properties that have been boarded up for more than 6 months. And she said there is a limit here.
Money, nonprofit, and making it a business. It's frustrating to look around and approach our neighbors and have them. I have someone that wants to rent your unit, they want to lease it, they want to put a restaurant in. Not interested, don't bother me. And that's kind of like hitting the brick wall, really. So it'd be nice if there's other ways, either through, catch more flies behind your unit.
Talk to your supervisor, Mayor.
I've outreached to a number of the property owners and have similar We have no power to do eminent domain. So we can't do that. But I do think what Ellen said is appropriate in certain instances where we can have code enforcement to go in and take some aggressive action.
I'm just curious how the cities get away with eminent domain.
They have their own powers. The county will not use, we only use eminent domain for rare occasions to acquire easements for public right-of-way and bridge projects and road projects.
Is that just a county policy or?
It's most cities now, and it's sort of the fallout from the dissolution of development.
One of the tools that we were told about is that aggrieved neighbors or other businesses can take them to small claims court.
I've had experience with neighborhoods doing that specifically for drug houses, and it's been successful.
I can see drug houses, but just dilapidated buildings that have been there for 10 years.
There are a couple of them that have been boarded up for a very long time. Yeah. Yep, we all agree on that.
Yeah, I'm pretty concerned, right? If you're looking at putting 100 new houses on Verona, which is going to be 200 cars, and it's all gridlock. But right, you have like the cabanas down there, which is next to Mike's garage. I mean, that thing looks like a fire truck is falling apart. So I don't know, it seems to me like, why can't we put more energy into rehabilitating, you know, places that are already falling into the ground rather than building 100 new units on an incredibly crowded street and a highway that can't really probably accommodate 200 more cars. It seems like, I don't know, it seems like a fast, awkward way of developing rather than setting the cabanas. Looks like it's one matchstick away from all of them.
Yeah.
And code enforcement is working with Las Cabanas. Yes.
The last time I went by, there were tarps and bungee cords and everything.
Yeah, good point. You were waiting here. Thank you.
Thank you. So I just moved back to California, so this is all new to me. Thank you for the very nice presentation, and thank you to everyone who put so much work into this whole process. I just have a couple of quick one question is, I have three little kids. Is there any, in the plan, is there any play infrastructure closer to the center of the Springs or opportunity for it?
The plaza could have some sort of play area, I suppose, but no, there is nothing more in the center of the community. Larson Park, there's a connector contemplated between the highway and the park. The issue is pretty much is that we are built out quite a bit. I'm sorry, Susan.
Thank you. Welcome to the community. I'm delighted that you're here with the children. The master plan update for Maxwell Park, Regional Park, and Larson will be moving forward very soon. The EIR is almost completed, and it will go through a similar process to what Yolanda described for this. And we're also looking for funding. We know that potential construction of a hotel and the Mid-Pan Housing Project, sadly, all failed. We'll have to move, and we're desperately trying to find funding for that field in Maxwell Park. So I'm delighted you're here, and stay tuned. And if you have any ideas on things that may be appropriate and intrigue and interest children, suggest that.
I will, thank you. So one thing I actually think would be quite helpful would be is they make these playgrounds that are take up hardly any space and are designed for very small kids, and there are a lot of very small kids that live far enough that if you want to take them to either park at either end of the Springs, you pretty much have to put them in the car.
Mm-hmm.
The sidewalks are all kind of clogged with poles and trees that are planted in the middle of the sidewalk. You usually block the sidewalk, and so it's hard to roll anybody in a stroller to either park, and so you have to drive there. And even, even 100 square feet of toddler-sized playground at in an odd corner of the plaza or anywhere along there,
mm-hmm.
I think would get a tremendous amount of use and would be a valuable resource.
The plan does advocate pocket parks. And those are just little green spaces, not taking much room. You probably see them in the city. And so that would be a wonderful opportunity for a little play area and then benches or, you know, for... So, yes, so we do have that in the plan.
Okay.
Yeah.
And on here, though, I don't see that on here.
No, it's a policy in the plan itself, and you can view that online.
Okay.
Yeah, and I actually have a copy of it if you'd like to take a look at it, but it is a discussion draft and subject to change.
Mm-hmm. And then, just quickly, the other thing I was going to raise, which you've already partly said, is I hope that once this is all done, this strip will have much better sidewalks than it does. Is that part of the plan?
So,
wide open sidewalks there?
Well, so right now, of course, you know, they're nice new sidewalks, most of them, but fairly narrow, you
right.
know, right 5 feet. And so,
something stuck in the middle.
Yeah. So what the plan is advocating is that with new development, now this is a slow process, but with new development, that new development, rather than being set up right to the edge of the 5 foot sidewalk, to be set back 5 feet. And then that area, and that's how we would expand those sidewalks out. So it would be a 10-foot sidewalk, and then the front of the building would be there. We also, it also provides for it being set back even further if a business wanted to provide an outdoor dining area. So because we can't push into the street for wider sidewalks, we're proposing that it go out the other way with development. It'll be a slow process, but there is that potential.
In the building parking lots, but we barely have now.
No, with new development, if you're building, a new building is coming in, rather than building right up to the edge of the 5 foot sidewalk,
right.
There's a... That's right. That's right. It's something that occurs over time.
Like a 5-foot, 6-foot, 8-foot gap there between the road and the sidewalk.
So it would be filled in with a sidewalk.
So you are saying it's pushing towards the road, not toward
the road, but toward development, out the other way. So let me explain this again. So you've got a 5 foot sidewalk, and you have somebody that's going to come in and maybe demo a building and rebuild, or build in a vacant lot. Well, it is quite true that it will take a long time to see change, but you have to start somewhere. If you don't have a plan, it never happens.
Right, but for example, if you look at the sidewalks, there's trees, which is super annoying. But then you've got, in front of my business,
mm-hmm.
between the horrible sidewalk
mm-hmm.
and the road, there's enough for a car to walk. So why aren't we pushing the sidewalk into the road space? That isn't really the road.
So there's 8 foot area for the bicycle lane right now, and then what's being proposed? Well, what's being proposed with the plan is, well, if you're on a bike, it doesn't feel like it's above normal when you've got cars going. So the bike lane would be reduced, and the bike lane, when they say 8 feet, it's counting the gutter pan. So when you're riding along, if you've ever done that, it's, you know, I always try to stay to the right, but you're like right in the gutter pan. So you'd have your bike lane 5 feet, and then you'd have a 2 to 3 foot buffer on that side painted.
But there's still no way to expand it wider, because most of the buildings are staying. I'm not going to give up more on my parking lot to make. So you're going to have.
So it would not. You would not be asked to do that.
A new building.
Right. Yeah, you would not be asked to do that. This would be new development. That would, and you're right. It's going to take a long time. Well, but you have to start somewhere. If you don't have that, then the development continues as it is.
Okay.
Can I just remind people how long it took to get sidewalks?
Yeah. Yeah.
Sidewalks are good. No sidewalks.
Yeah.
I understand that there was a separate presentation on the proposed plaza, and I didn't get to go to that, but I remember But was there any mention of a possible branch of the public library going into some of that open space next to the post office, for example?
We do have a policy in the plan, the draft plan, that advocates for a library, and I can find it for you if you come over and I can show it to you afterward. We don't have it mapped anywhere. Next to the plaza is a great idea. We don't have it mapped anywhere, but they are a permitted use along that corridor. Yeah.
So this was something, I just want to mention that this was something that our group was exploring, and member of our executive committee who took it on as her project, but for family reasons, she's not doing it, so we're looking for somebody who would like to head up that committee.
Well, I don't have the number of the committee head, the county head of the library committee, and I tried to call. He was on vacation, but I'm willing to call and find out what exactly the procedures are.
Yeah, I mean, we certainly have met with the current temporary director. We met with the friends at the library. So we've kind of gotten it a little bit further along. As far as it's a long process, it's an expensive process, but a good goal. It's a good goal. So, we would love to have somebody head that up. So, I'll take your name. I'll take your name.
I just want to let you know that your community advisory team is made up of about 12 or 15 people. Some of them are this evening. Night before last they met, there were two citizens watching what they were doing. They were making significant decisions about color, sidewalk, parking, setbacks, height of buildings, and nobody is there to sort of give input to them. Those good citizens are making decisions on behalf of everyone. They are going to meet again and continue this process, and I would watch for that meeting date and show up and hear what they're doing and the decisions they're making. And I also have a question, and that is, there are a couple of significant projects now in the works that have already gone, I don't know whether they're a PRMD or where, but they have significant impact on parking and on housing. And how will the rules that we eventually adopt affect those people, or will they?
If they are in the works now, our plan has not been adopted yet. So if there is something in the works now, it would proceed forward. This plan, like I said, will probably not be adopted until next year, early next year. And as far as the Citizens Advisory Team, at all of our meetings, we've had a list of those members with their email addresses and their phone numbers for people to call them and tell them what they think. So it's another way of making your voice heard also. So give your members a call. I don't think I have them any with me today, but they are on the website as well, the list. They want to hear from you. And also, this what they are doing now is moving our project forward. But again, it's not final until it's actually adopted. So if they were to decide on something that you're not really in favor of, like I said, you're going to have that opportunity to have your voice heard at the Planning Commission, at the Board of Supervisors, and you can send letters. All of those letters, like I said, get to the decision makers when we take those projects forward. So they do have your comments, and if there are a lot of them, we summarize those as well.
Well, I don't mean to be negative. I think many of the decisions they were making the other night, at least from my point of view, were very favorable and positive.
That's good to hear.
I mean, but we should know what they're doing.
Absolutely. Yeah. Yes.
So I also just want to insert information about a project that the Department of Health is doing with the Obesity Prevention Department, or program, pardon me. Something that they did in Roseland was put water stations, and I did ask Laura Chambers to talk to you to include the water stations as part of the specific plan. But this is actually something that could be even done before this is even approved.
Oh, of course. I mean, if you have funding for it.
Yeah, I just got an email from the person who was taking over her job meanwhile, she's on maternity leave. But there's actually, and we'll post this on Facebook or website, there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 possible locations. And the county's already started to talk with Valley of the New Water District, and they already approved one site. So the sites would be like having one like where McDonald's is, possibly one at Thompson right here, one over Calle del Monte where the Boys Center is, and in front of where the Boys Hot Springs bus stop is, and right by Teen Center, and right by Better's Apartments. So they are, we'll be looking for community members to be part of the group that will be decision making, and also looking for property owners that will adopt more water stations. So the water stations are basically one like for drinking for adults, and then one where you put your insert your water bottle, and then one for so we will put in that, if anyone's interested in being part of that decision making, and if we could get the six, that would be awesome.
We do have it in the plan.
Yeah.
And maybe you've seen that, and a photograph of one as well.
Yeah, I did talk to Laura, like, you know, there's this, so if you want to make sure it's kind of permanent, put it in there.
Yes, yes. She caught in touch with us and we did it. Hi.
Hi. I have a suggestion for a little mini park. Susan Gordon, I don't know, this land that is at the corner of Mountain,
yes,
and Highway 12.
I'm working on an idea.
For a little park there?
Maybe.
All right.
I'll help you. Anytime you talk about that, you need a willing property owner.
Absolutely.
But I have an idea.
It's kind of a dead space.
It is. It's been that way for a long time. Well, at least it doesn't have the falling down for a building.
So we could buy it and make it a park.
I wanted to actually comment on Tom's comment about attending meetings because a lot of decisions are being made.
Thank you. Thanks for being
here. When the highway was put in, the second part of the highway was put in, you know, the guidelines actually were, as far as I know, the guidelines were set aside, old original guidelines were set aside. And that was because we had new guidelines in the works. So what is really kind of, what is very disappointing to me is that these little paths that I have here are all violations of the original guidelines. So in many ways, even the language of these guidelines is critically important, whether something should be done or something must be done, and that was some of the decisions we made the other day. But even after things are in the works, properties or developers come in, it's my conclusion, just as a citizen, you have to be very aware of what's going on and check it out. I mean, did it actually adhere to any kind of principles or guidelines? I do want to mention that the two developers that you had mentioned, the Matsons with the Boys Food Center project and the Container, the Springs Noodles project, Tim Sloat is their designer planner, I believe, their architect. He's going to be presenting at the September meeting, and he's going to bring us up to date on what they are thinking about. And they're definitely, they have a plan that includes a lot of the elements that we're looking for. The last thing I wanted to mention was not only are we looking for willing owners for land and for water stations, but we're looking for willing owners who will adopt trees. We want to restore the trees that were taken down before the sidewalks. They had to be taken down. Well, now we need to find people who are willing to help the trees and the trees. As far as I know, they're still available from the Sinaloa Ecology Center. So if you know anybody, please and invisibility of the highway. Please let them know that there's a tree program available. They have to maintain their trees themselves, but at least there's somebody who has a tree for them, and they get a choice of options, and they would be able to have a plan for them. So let you know about that. So we've got about 8 minutes left. Are there any last questions that anybody
else? Yes. I mean, plans are good, and a lot of this stuff is really exciting. I'm wondering if the county, because in order to do some of these things, change the springs in any significant way, you're going to have people willing to invest money. And that's been a real challenge in the springs, because there just hasn't been a lot of incentive to do that. Is the county going to have, I guess, Susan can answer this too. Any incentives? Has anybody talked about incentives for development to actually create, you know, investors that are willing to spend dollars? Because without them, not much will happen.
I think
Bobby,
you've raised a really good question, and it's something that you would all want to work towards. So we've had private conversations with property owners, and we will continue to have public conversations about the property owners, maybe use code enforcement, but I don't have at hand financial incentives to help them. But I have to say, one of the reasons, one of the primary reasons for this spring specific plan is to move forward exactly as we're doing. By rezoning some of these properties, it will encourage investment in the property, it will make it much easier for investors to consider ideas in the future, since we have made the efforts to already do rezoning. And so parking is a conundrum. There may have to be consideration of a parking district in the future, but if there is a parking district, the whole property owners will have to vote on it and support it financially with monthly assessments. That's a little bit down the road, but and I know it's one of the big conversation points since I've been elected as supervisor. The good news is we've completed negotiations for the lot just immediately adjacent to the Parsons Hardware. We are rapidly trying to get the cost estimates for grading and perhaps graveling and open that up to replacement parking. I'm looking at another site for your north for replacement parking, and I'm trying desperately. This is now the third year or second year. I'm working on parking enforcement so that we can actually get the cars that are parked around the Central Plaza building to move. Those are employees from the Sonoma Mission Inn. Those are residents from the Valley Glen Apartments. And hopefully the replacement parking will give the Valley Glen Apartment residents a place to park so that we can actually get some tenanting in Jack Mendelinas' building at the Center Plaza building and get the community hub moving, which is actually sort of conflicting with our need for parking because it will require some space. So I mean, thank you all, first of all, for being here. I think it's really important to have the authentic voice of the community to comment on the plan, and I welcome your participation in the CAC discussions, Planning Commission discussions. Any comment letters that you turn in will all be positive. If you have any ideas on what we could do to keep our families in the Springs and give the families and our children an outlet to play in, and I hear you, I really wish we had great big wide sidewalks, and I want to harken back to what my tracker said. We're so fortunate to have sidewalks. It was such a struggle to get the sidewalks and to get a little greenery in the trees. Yes, they are planted in the sidewalks. ADA issue was front and center in all of the design considerations. So it's an evolution. It's a journey. Bobby, you've been at this for a very long time. Shepherd, wherever you are, Bill Bloom, we're part of the redevelopment. And Rich and Ellen, thank you for your perseverance and your persistence.
I do have a sort of a question with one of the things you raised, and that's the obviously the parking lot in the center of the Springs next to the post office there, yeah. The empty building that's been empty for a while, as well as the other building that's been ready to fall down. Has there been any long-term plan? I mean, I respect there's a very good business person there that has a very busy auto garage right in the heart of our area. There was an opportunity, and I don't know if other opportunities will come up, the old Universal garage at the far end of the Springs would have been a wonderful place for the county to say, look, how can we give you some incentives to move so possibly we could actually have a real plaza in the center of the Springs. I don't know what could be done with that. I'm talking about creative plans and trying to help people not lose their business, promote their business, and figure out ways as a community that we could help somebody's business and not detract from their business at the same time, create something really valuable to the whole community.
It's a wonderful business, and the business has turned over, and we have a great business owner there, and obviously by the number of cars that we have parked there, we love that business. We want them to repair all of our cars. When we've had those discussions with previous owner and the current owner, they know that their time is limited in that location. They do that at some point it will be in their best interest and our best interest to move to a different location. So we can have a sensitive conversation about that, but we need to really reach out to the property owner, which is not the business owner, to have that conversation. And I don't have a lot of money that I can just say, I'm going to offer you $6 million for your property.
The property's not worth $6 million.
And
I'm also depends on how you zone it.
And I'm also having conversations with Karen Waikiki about other counties. Okay. So I think it's going to be very exciting for the future. There's a lot of private conversations, and I think the key to the there's incredible energy in this area, and thank you all for that. It's my game plan to get a advisory council up and running by the beginning of next year. We're hoping to have some of the details worked out so that we can bring it forward on the board agenda in October and have the appointments and the boundaries established in the bylaws. So I'm excited about that. And once that happens, I think that you working through the municipal advisory council will find your voice. And you're going to be far more persuasive with some of the property owners to maybe move in a more positive direction and redevelop those parcels. Good times ahead. Thanks, Abby.
Can we just quickly talk to you what was just brought up briefly around the traffic speed limit, getting CHP, or, you know, my understanding is the sheriff can't give out tickets, the police don't give out tickets. How can we get people to slow down?
If it is to be, it starts with me. And if each one of us drives 25 down the highway from Hacienda to the donut shop and back, then they will get the grip. And the same thing, MacArthur, it's 25 on MacArthur, boys and girls. It's 25 on Spain from Fifth Street West into the plaza. And if you're behind me, that's what you drive.
And
your road, where Cayenne is 30.
I suggest to everybody that we all drive the speed limit, if not under it. But as our supervisor, he's asking what is being done, because I think you're hearing.
there's parking right next door. So I'm being a little bit more militant.
We can put them on the website so we can print them and carry them.
Yes,
because we all see that violation, and I think that would be helpful. We can just, you know, we're going to sign our name, just put it on the windshield wiper and keep on going.
Yep.
In front of the donut shop, it's in front of Andy's Liquors.
Sadly, La Jolla Hacienda, they have lots of new parking behind, and I see it in front of La Jolla Hacienda. And my Melina says, your place, I understand.
I see it there. We have our own sign, specifically for you.
That's fabulous. I think some of these folks are already on it, but I will add any lines. Thank you. That's great. Alrighty. I appreciate it.
We're welcome.
And to have a conversation about what you expect.
In this plan, there are also going to be crosswalks.
Of course.
Take this in close.
Hey.
Make an announcement real quick.
This one did before they leave.
Yeah, go ahead.
Thank you, everybody. If you got to get your attention real quick. The Sonoma Valley Citizens Advisory Commission meeting is 6:30 next Wednesday, and we'll be carrying it live on SVTV if you can't make it. And the repeats will be 10 a.m. and 10 p.m. the next day, Thursday, and it will also be on YouTube. And just go to sonomatv.org to watch it. Thank you.
Thanks, everybody. And before you leave, I just wanted to mention that we accept donations to support the Springs Community Alliance. We have expenses in terms of renting this space for our meetings and insurance and website upkeep. So feel free to throw a couple bucks in the jar. And we're also looking for meeting sponsors. Like last month's meeting was sponsored by Sonoma Valley Hospital. So if you know of a business or other entity that would like to sponsor a meeting, let us know. Thank you. Good night. Thank you, everybody.